Sound design.
All right, let's talk about getting your first measurement set up in Smaart DI. So when you open up Smaart DI for the first time, it should look something like this. There's no traces over here. None of this stuff is set up. And the first thing you want to do is open up the options, the config, the IO config. And you can either do that from this menu or by choosing option A, okay? I recommend that first you just choose the right input and output device. So go through this list and just check and uncheck everything that you want. Okay, right now I only have one thing going here. I don't want it to offer me any of this other stuff. Okay, the next thing you want to do is take a look at these input names down here and give them friendly names to make this easier on yourself. And be aware that hitting tab, like in other pieces of software, will not save your input. So if I change this to hello and hit tab, it's going to revert back to ref. If I hit return, it takes me to the next line and saves. My second input in this case is going to be my reference input. And then my third input will be this microphone up here. Can't see it. It's behind this other microphone. The EMX7150. And then the fourth one will be this microphone that you can see. 3000L, I think. Okay, that's all we need to do here. We named the microphones. And you can name the outputs if you want to, but I don't really care that much about that. I'm only using output one anyway. Now let's take a look at this next tab. Oh, one thing to consider here. The sample rate. The only thing I want you to keep in mind about the sample rate is that you want to keep it consistent as much as possible. I have had problems in the past where I've done some measurements, saved some traces at 44.1K, and then tried to import them into a 48K session, and you can't do that. So just keep it consistent. That shouldn't be a problem. If you're just taking measurements during a tuning in one day, it should always be at the same sample rate. Okay, next tab, measurement config. Now you're not gonna have any of these extra ones set up yet. So all you're gonna see is default TF. And really that's all you need at the beginning if you're just measuring with a single channel. We'll get into creating new pairs later, but for now, all you really need is the default TF. These are all just the standard settings that this comes with, except for the input settings. So this is where I'm going to choose my reference input and my measurement input. And as you can see here, they're backwards right now. So for my measurement input, I want that to be the 7150. For the default transfer function, that's what TF stands for. And for the reference signal, I want it to be my reference, my loop that I created. Here is a problem that I've had. I don't know if it's a bug, maybe it's just happening to me, but probably check this every time you open. All right, these are settings you should just go through quickly every time you open Smaart DI, every time you're, you know, on site in the field, getting ready for some new work. Open these up, just go through them real quick, make sure everything is as it should. Here's why. I have noticed several times that I open up Smaart DI and this is not as I saved it. For some reason, these can get switched around. And if they do, everything's gonna look wonky. Okay, I can actually show you what that looks like in a future video. But for now, we're just gonna go through all the settings you need to go through the first time you open up Smaart DI. Okay, by the way, one way around that possible bug, possible saving problem that I found is to create a new signal pair. So if you create a new signal pair, give it a new name, we'll call this one A. And then we choose the reference input and, oops, I did that wrong. The measurement input and the reference input. Then I found that that will not get forgotten. The next time I open up Smaart DI, that should be correct. Anyway, I've got my default TF set up here. Measurement input, reference signal, and I can hit OK. The last thing we need to set up is the signal generator. So that's here under the options menu, or you can hit option N to open that up. These are all default settings. The only thing you really need to look at is to make sure that you've got the right output device selected here and the right output. What is aux? So you guys know that I recommend that when you're first starting out, you just use a Y cable and take the output from your audio interface and immediately loop one of your splits back into the input. Okay, that's the easiest way to do it. You know exactly where the signal's going. You know that this is an exact copy of what you have coming out of the output. This is now going to get connected to your speaker or whatever you're measuring. If you don't have a Y cable, then you might have an audio interface like the one I have down here. This Behringer unit has a copy, it has two outputs for each output. That is, for the left output, it has an XLR output and a TRS output. So I use the TRS output to loop back in for my reference input, and I use the XLR output to go to the speaker. If you don't have that, that's where this aux output can come in handy. So if I didn't have this Y cable, then what I could do is choose output one for my main output and then output two right here for my aux output. And all that's gonna do is send an exact copy of the same measurement signal to both of these outputs. That way I can just take a TRS cable from output one, loop it back to my input one, reference input, and then I can take output two and send that along to my speaker or whatever I'm measuring. That's what the aux output is for. I'm not using it right now. Okay, those are all the settings you need. Now you should be able to go to spectrum view right away, which you can do by hitting the S key or by click on spectrum. And now you should immediately see some measurements here. Now, if you're not seeing measurements, but you are seeing your meters dance around up here, then let's take a look at what we actually have selected here. Now we want to see our reference input and the measurement microphone. Okay, and to actually see that measurement here in the spectrum, I need to hit the play button here and make those active. Okay, so now I obviously am looking at the measurement microphone in the room. That's the green one, right? The 7150. That's how you can tell them apart. I don't have any signal coming in on the blue one yet because I haven't turned the signal generator on. But I can still see this noise floor. There is some signal here. Obviously, it's not nothing. If I were to unplug it 100%, there's nothing plugged in right now. We can still look at that though. The reason we don't see it here is that it's too far down on the graph. So if you ever have a signal that's too low, so right now, what if I actually turn this microphone all the way down? So now I've turned both of these all the way down. I'll reset this display by hitting the V key. And so you might have this situation where you open this up and you're like, oh wow, it's way down here, I can barely read it. Or maybe you don't see it at all because your signal is just too low. Now if you click over here and that doesn't do it, then use the arrow keys and scroll down until you actually see your measurement, and there we go. So that's how you can see if you have things plugged in and set up correctly. Okay, and then you should be able to head back over to the transfer function window by pressing the T key or pressing transfer, and then you select whichever of the pairs you set up. In our case, we just set up the default TF. And you should be able to go ahead and turn on your signal generator and see a measurement there. So in the next videos, we'll get into actually verifying whether or not we have good data, because one of the first questions that I had and that everybody always has when they first start is, now that I've gotten a measurement, what are all these squiggly lines? Okay, so you're gonna take a measurement and then you're gonna get something like this and you're gonna say, wow, what is all this stuff? And you take another measurement like, what do I do with this, right? And I think the first question is this even good, valid data? So in the next video, I'm gonna go through these same steps with the full version of Smaart and then with SatLive, and then we're gonna start looking at how to actually know if we have good data.
Sound design.